time. But God isn't just kind of good. God isn't a little good. God is really good. How's everyone feeling?
Awesome.
Awesome. I'm feeling pretty awesome myself. Can we give God a praise and our worship team and the band and all the great stuff? We are continuing our series, week number two. Last week we talked about the power of eating together, just having a meal with one another. And so today we're going to actually be talking about redefining what it means to be perfect. Redefining what it means to be perfect. So before we launch out into this talk, would you please just for 1 second pause and pray with me real quick. Father God in heaven, right now in this moment, we pray that you would please surround us and live inside of us. And God, take this ordinary moment and turn it into an extraordinary experience whereby we can leave and say, truly, we heard God today. Truly, we felt, we sensed, we connected with heaven today. God, we don't want to leave the same way that we came in today. Today, we want an encounter with you. Speak to us is our prayer in Jesus' name. Jesus. Let everyone say,
amen.
Amen. Amen. I've grown up and I've had an issue. And that issue is something that I think that we all can kind of relate to, and that I have a hard time dealing with this conception called perfection. Mm-hmm. And so every day when I wake up and I look at myself in the mirror, there are things that I like about myself, and there are things that I wish that I could change. Mm. When I look at myself, Joshua Aaron Rios, I struggle, and although I know that perfection can never really be attained, I know this, yet I put the pressure on myself to be perfect. For some of you, you might struggle with the perfection of being a perfect husband or a perfect wife. Or maybe for those of you who have kids, you struggle with, I want to be a perfect parent. Or maybe you look at yourself physically, and I know this, I'm 31 years old, but just to be comfortable in your own skin, I think one of the hardest things to do is to really start to love yourself. Because I'm struggling with this thing called perfection, and really, for me to be perfect, what I have to do is really be fake. For me to be perfect means that I have to hide and conceal parts of me that I really don't want you to see. And so my question to myself and for all of us is, are we willing to allow ourselves to be seen? Because all of us want to connect with each other. I mean, one of the most powerful things that we can do as human beings is connect. But I can't connect with you if I don't allow myself to be real. And question, when's the last time you really connected on a deep level with a perfect person? Matter of fact, those people are kind of annoying. You know any perfect people? And I remember growing up, you know, my dad would always tell me, man, like, you're so strong, or, you know, how do you do it, or, you know, certain things about me. But really, as I reflect, what it was I wasn't really opening up and allowing him to see the broken me. The me that was the real me. And so I was struggling, and so my dad thought I was this person super strong. The reality is, it was not that I wasn't really strong. He had a misconception of who I was because I didn't let him into my world. And that ideology of being perfect made its way into my religion and my spiritual encounter. I thought that I had to be perfect before I could talk to God. Anybody feel like that? Religion taught me that I had to be perfect before I could go to church. I remember I had a manager, I invited him to church one time, a long time ago. He said, John, there's no way I'm going to go to church. If I go to church, as soon as I step on church grounds, the ground's going to swallow me up. It's funny, but it's not funny because That shows us the mentality of what most people think about God and church. Mm. And really, God has not given God a bad, himself a bad name. You and I at times have given God a bad name. And so here we are. I transferred this idea that I had to be perfect, walking on the eggshells of religion. And I was so focused on being perfect that I couldn't focus on my relationship with God.
Wow.
It was like, imagine if I went on a date, you know, and I went on a date with this girl, and her brother told me, hey, she doesn't like the color green. Whatever you do, don't wear the color green. Got it. Don't wear the color green. She hates Italian food. Don't take her to anything Italian or Mexican or Chinese. She don't like any of that stuff. Okay? No green, no Italian, no Mexican. Got it, no Chinese. Make sure that when you pick her up, you don't open the door. Because if you open her door, she's actually going to get offended. What? Are you serious? And make sure when you guys hang out, you don't stare into her eyes too long. She thinks that's weird, you know? Don't make any eye contact with her. And he gives me this long list of all the things that I shouldn't do. Well, I'm so focused on the things that I shouldn't do that I have no time to pay attention to the relationship. And you and I have been introduced by religion about a long set of rules that we're so concerned about keeping that we're afraid that if we break them, God is somehow going to be mad at us, hate us, and not love us. And God's saying, listen, you're focusing so much on the rules, on the do's and the don'ts, that you don't even notice when I'm here. Wow. Matter of fact, I'm right here, right now. Do you sense me? Do you hear me? Do you feel me? And so, where do we get this idea of perfect? Well, Jesus actually said it himself. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 48, he says, you are to be what?
Perfect.
Perfect, even as your Father in heaven is what?
Perfect.
Wait a minute, Jesus. For you to say this, this means that you actually think that I can live up to the standard of being perfect like God. Raise a hand. How many of you guys think you can be perfect like God? Even on your best day, right? The Bible says that even our righteousness is a filthy rag compared to God. Even all of your good doing, everything that you do that's perfect, he says that's still a filthy rag. So what is Jesus talking about if he's challenging us and saying, hey, I want you to be perfect just like your Father in heaven is perfect? Well, we got to get some context. And here's the context. In Matthew chapter 5, starting with verse 43, Jesus says this. You have heard the rule that says, love your neighbor and what?
Hate your enemy.
Did you know that that's in the Bible? It's in Leviticus. Back in the day, they taught, love your neighbor and hate your enemies. You know, that's that whole, any fathers in the house? Yeah. And did you ever tell your kids that, hey, if someone hits you, you hit them right back?
Yeah.
Yeah. That you love your own, but you better, you know, fight those who are against you. Well, this is what Leviticus taught. But then Jesus comes and he goes, but I tell you. Now look what he says. This part is crazy, but I say, love your what?
Enemies.
Love your enemies. Any enemies that you got? Yeah. No enemies in here, right?
No.
He says, bless those who do what?
Curse you.
Curse you. I don't know about you, but when someone curses me out, you know what wants to come out of my mouth?
The same thing.
Same right back to them. Then it says, pray for those who do what?
Persecute you.
I know in my prayer life, what my prayer life has normally looked like is I pray for all of my loved ones, you know? My cousins, my aunt, my uncle, my grandma, my grandparents, you know, my brothers, my sisters, my parents. Those are the people I'm praying for. Jesus says, pray for the people that persecute you. And we're so selfish that all we think about is our own little circle of people. And she says, no, pray for those who persecute you. Why would you ask me to pray for somebody who's persecuting you? Because God says this. You think you're praying for them to change. But when you start praying for them, you start naming them, what's actually going to happen? God says, I'm going to change you and your outlook towards them. And all of a sudden, the persecution that you're giving you, it's going to be like Teflon, and it'll just roll right off. Why? Because I'm going to live in you, and I'm going to give you new thoughts, a new heart, a new mind, new desires. I'm going to give you something that you, of your own self, cannot possess. When you start praying for those who persecute you, all of a sudden you're not as annoyed as you used to be. And then he says this, do evil. Do what?
Good.
Do good to those who not just accuse you, but those who spitefully accuse you and hate you. Do good to those who spitefully accuse you and hate you. How many of you guys like doing what Jesus just told us to do? Huh? Yo, Jesus, I love you and all, and there's certain parts that I like about you, but when you talk about this, I don't know about that, but you lost me. But that's what you want me to do? Yeah. Well, why? He says, in that way, you will be acting as what?
True children
of your Father in heaven. For he gives his sunlight to both the evil and the good, and he sends rain on the just and the unjust alike. If you love only those who love you, what reward is that? Even corrupt tax collectors do that much. And of course, back in Bible times, tax collectors were hated, right? Today we find them like, you know, our taxes paid so much money. Right? And then he says, if you are kind only to your friends, how are you different from anyone else? Even Gentiles do that. And this is what he says in verse 48. Therefore, you will be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. So Jesus isn't saying perfect is not about ever messing up or falling. Jesus is redefining perfection. He's saying perfection is being able to love like your Father in heaven loves. That's what perfect is all about. It's not about, well, I can't do this, and I can't go here, and I can't watch this. And now, I'm not saying go out there and live a foolish life, because the reality is we reap what we sow. If I make dumb decisions, I'm going to sow those things. But Jesus is saying, hey, what it actually means to be perfect is to start loving like God. And so here's what I want to share with you. That word perfect is actually, the word is teleos. Everyone say teleos.
Teleos.
That's Greek, and it literally means fully grown or mature. So if you want to kind of substitute that word, when Jesus says be perfect, he's really saying be mature. Because a mature person, right, doesn't do this. Hey, if you hit me, I'm going to hit you back. That's an immature person. Jesus says that a mature, fully grown person who's spiritual in God can actually love their enemies, can pray for those who persecute them, can actually do good to those who spitefully accuse and those who hate us. Jesus says, when you grow in your spirituality, when you want to be perfect, he says, actually get mature. Church, stop being immature is what Jesus is saying. Church, religion, right? All these, it's amazing to me that Christians are always fighting each other about who's right and who's wrong. We got the truth, right? Baptists got the truth. Adventists got the truth. Catholics got the truth. These people, everyone claims to have the truth. Jesus says that's immature. Maturity transcends all of those things. He says, you really want to be perfect? He says, be mature. And what it means mature from going through the necessary what?
Stages
to reach the end goal, developed by fulfilling the necessary process to get there. So you and I are actually going through some things in life. And life is a way of cutting us, yeah? Think right now of the most annoying person in your life. Think right now of the person that just drives you crazy. Hopefully it's not your spouse. But if it is, actually that's a blessing in disguise. Here's why. Because you gotta wake up every day to that annoying person. And what that actually does is it's developing you.
Yeah.
You think it's about them, they need to change. No, it's about you need to change. And God is calling us. He's saying, listen, and the only way you're gonna get to this full maturity, it's not by being perfect. Listen, we all know this. If you and I have lived life long enough, I've learned more in my failures than I have in my successes. The story of the prodigal sons, yeah? There's one son, he's the older brother, he's perfect. He keeps the law, he does everything perfect. And he's not close to God. Then the young son, he messes up, does everything wrong. He gets it wrong. Guess what? He gets it wrong, but he comes to the Father. It's almost as if when we get it wrong, you guys, it's a way for our heart to actually open up and say, man, God, I need you. I need you. Because I can't make it without you. So here's my redefinition of what it means to be perfect. Being perfect means giving others and yourself the grace to grow through imperfections. I'll read it again. Being perfect means giving others and yourself the grace to grow through your imperfections. It's not about being perfect, the end goal. It's about the process in between of saying, I'm going to give people this space. The Apostle Paul says it like this in Colossians chapter 3. He says, make allowance for what? Make what? Make what?
Allowance.
For each other's faults and forgive anyone who what?
Offends you.
Remember, the Lord forgave you, so treat each other the way he's done what?
Treated you. Wow.
Above all, what else, Paul? Clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect what? So when we're perfect, it's actually we're being perfect in our love. And perfect love gives people the space to mess up. Can you imagine? I remember I was counseling this younger girl one time, and we did it was a group of our youth, and she had such a hard time because she was thinking that she had to be perfect. She had such a stress on her that she didn't want to disappoint her parents. Somehow, her parents had made her feel that she had to be perfect. Straight A's, and be the best that you can be. And those things are good, but she was so broken that we literally had to role play her talking to her parents and saying, because her parents wanted her to go to medical school and be a doctor. So she had this pressure of becoming a doctor, and she said, I don't want to be a doctor, I actually just want to be a nurse. I said, well, why don't you just tell your parents? She said, I can't tell them that. They're going to be so mad at me. They're going to be disappointed. Why? Because you and I are always living with this false reality that we think we have got to be perfect in some area in our life. Mm-hmm. We all have it. Every one of us has something that we think, okay, I got to just make, you know, before I can have kids, I got to make this amount of money, right? Or before I can get back into a relationship, you know, maybe you're a single parent now, and you're like, I don't know if I can date anymore. That's over for me. I got to be perfect. I got to get this together. We all have something that we're working, that we're striving towards. So this girl, we role-played it. Would you know that we role-played it? I acted as the parents, blah, blah, blah. We did the whole thing. She started crying. Just lost it. Why? Because of the pressure of being perfect. So what I'm saying is that we redefine what it means to be perfect. Imagine the pressure that we would take off on each other, on our relationships with each other, on our kids, on our spouses, even at work, whatever it might be, any area in our life. Right? A lot of times we treat people, we'll never say, I expect you to be perfect. I'll never say that, but I'll live it. I get all pissed off when you do something the way, or even perfectionist, something as simple as this. You throw a party, right? Anybody like to throw parties? Don't lie. Anybody like to throw parties? Right? And the type A personalities, the perfectionists, are so, you know, all about being perfect. They'll get even mad at the way you're lining up the bottles of water. No, the water doesn't go like that.
OCD.
You know?
Yeah.
And we're putting all this unnecessary stress on ourselves and on others because of our definition of what it means to be perfect. And Jesus says, no. Being perfect actually just means allowing yourself and others the space, the allowance to make faults. It's okay. Amen. All right, let's move right along. So how do we do this? Good question, right? I mean, my goodness, God, you want me to love my enemies, and you want me to be cool with people who hate me, and you want me to give people the room to make faults? I'm tired. My husband's making the same mistake for the past, not one day or 5 weeks, but for the past 5 years, he's been doing the same thing over and over. And you want me to give him room to make faults? How do we do it? Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, Paul says this. He says, we do this by keeping our eyes on who?
Jesus.
On who?
Jesus.
On Jesus, the author who initiates and finishes our faith.
Amen.
I was talking to God, and God told me, Josh, Stop reaching for perfection and reach for relationship. Stop reaching for perfection and start reaching for relationship. And that's what Paul's saying. He says, listen, keep your eyes on Jesus. Stop looking at you. Stop looking at the mirror and thinking that you have to be perfect and that you have to have it all figured out. God says, let me figure it out. Your job is just to keep your eyes on me. If you kept your eyes on me, you'd be surprised at how cool you'd be when someone normally makes you super upset. You're not going to get upset anymore. Because when you look full into my wonderful face, Jesus says, a face full of love and patience and compassion, he says, I will literally change you. Stop reaching for whatever your perfection is right now in life. God says, let it go. Reach for relationship. Paul says this again. He says, how foolish. But here's the funny thing. By default mode, we always want to go back to trying with our own efforts. If I just try harder, right? Mm-hmm. If I just do more, if I just become a better person. He says, how foolish can you what?
Be.
He's talking to the church at Galatia because they thought they could be saved by their works, you guys. They thought that if they just were good enough, if they did enough good works, God would love them. And Paul writes them and he's actually upset. He goes, how foolish can you be? I don't get it. After starting your new life in the Spirit, why are you now trying to become perfect by your own human effort? Tell me, why are you trying so hard? It's not about trying harder and reading more and praying to know more. It's more about just surrendering and letting go to Jesus.
Amen.
The more we let go and surrender our hearts and our minds, God says, I'll perfect that work inside of you. Mm. I'll do it. If not, it's a struggle. If not, I'll be honest with you, church is terrible. Church is terrible when we try to do it on our own effort. I remember growing up, my mom would make me go to church 15 years. I hated going to church.
It's true.
Mom, my God, I just want to play football. I want to go fishing. I don't want to go to church. It's the last thing I want to do. And because religion had taught me, like I said, just this formal tradition stuff. But then once I connected to relationship and started letting go and allowing Jesus to lead my life, everything changed. He says this also in Hebrews chapter 7, for those of us who love the law. He says, for the law never made anything what? The law never made anything perfect. But now we have confidence in a better hope, that hope Jesus, through which we draw near to who? Nothing wrong with the law. The law's perfect, but he says the law never made anything perfect. And we're going to finish up here. If I can get the band in just a second to play for us as we close up. So here's what we do. And this is what Paul says in Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. He says, I'm somewhat persuaded. I'm what? I've been persuaded, and I am
confident
that God, who what?
Began
a good work within you, will do what?
Continue his work.
Continue his work until it's finally finished on the day when what?
Jesus
Christ returns.
Here it is. You and I are never going to be perfect. I know what you're thinking. Oh, don't say that, Pastor, because that's going to give everyone the green card to go live crazy lives. Right? I'm telling you, you're never going to be perfect. Well, men are thinking as well, if I'm never going to be perfect, I'll just continue to, continue to smoke my crack. I don't smoke crack, but, I'll continue to go out every weekend and get just obliterated. I'll drink so much that I'll wake up, I want to remember what I did last night. I'll continue to make choices that are self-destructive. Because what's the point anyways? I'm never going to be perfect. And God says, sure, yeah, you can do all that. I'm still going to love you. It's never going to change my love for you. Never. It doesn't matter how good you are or how bad you are. God says, I'm going to love you exactly the same. Here's why. My love is not based on condition. My love is unconditional. And my love is so mature that I can handle your little mess. I can handle when you say, I don't believe in you, God. I can handle when you want nothing to do with me. I can handle it when you don't want to go to church. I can handle it when you don't feel like praying or reading your Bible. I can handle that. How, God? Because my love is so mature that it transcends all of that. And I feel mature no matter what. superior, that I'm confident. No, he has this experience with this man named Jesus. And he goes, I'm confident that God, who has begun a good work within me, is going to complete it when? When Jesus returns. Which means until Jesus comes, it's going to be happening for the rest of my life. I'm never going to get to a point where I'm perfect. So stop putting that stress on yourselves. Stop putting that stress on your kids. Stop putting that stress on relationships. Stop putting that stress on the ideal of what you think life should look like, because life is passing us by. The average person lives 29,000 days on planet Earth. 29,000 days. And every day that I live, I'm ticking down. Right now, I've been alive for about 11,980 days. If I'm lucky, I've got X amount of time left. And I don't have time to be wasting about being perfect. And wasting time on and looking at my spouse or people in my relationship, fighting them or stuff that doesn't matter. Paul says, hey, he's preaching to me. Paul says, hey, true love looks past all the faults. True love is able to let go of things that happened 5 years ago, that happened 3 weeks ago, matter of fact, that happened even today. Let it go. And we do that by giving ourselves to God and saying, God, I can't do it. I've tried. My human effort has not worked. I've tried all these things that I've been doing. I'm done. Church, I invite you at this time to pray with me. And if you want to just surrender your heart to God today, and you're saying, God, I'm tired of living with this pressure of being perfect. Religion taught me that I have to be perfect. I'm tired of living that life. I'm ready to allow you to be perfect for me, to be perfect in me, to be perfect through me. If that's what you want, to just pray right now that you just, everyone, just bow your head really quick. Just put some arm down, stand, or raise your hand, nothing like that. But right now, I want you to picture love. In your heart and your mind, picture God right now. Picture Jesus. See him smiling at you. See him loving on you. See him saying, you know what? You are actually my favorite person in the entire world. And I love you. And all you have to do is walk up to him in your heart and in your mind and say, God, I surrender. Help me to let go of my false expectations and to be in full relationship with you. If that's a choice God heard it, then starting this week, I believe in my heart that God will speak to you in ways that he's never spoken to you before. And you will have a personal encounter. God, we thank you so much for blessing us and being with us this afternoon. We praise you and give you all the glory, for you do deserve all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, you are dismissed. We are going to sing you out as we, you can stick around and sing with us, or you can head out, but let's sing.